Good morning, students. Today we are going to learn about another counter for the detection of the nuclear radiations, and that is the scintillation counter. So, the principle of the scintillation counter is, in scintillation counter, the incident radiation is first absorbed in the phosphor material and the atoms and molecules are excited. The excited atoms and molecules of the fluorescent material of the phosphor emit optical photons, which are nothing but the light flashes. And these light flashes are called as the scintillations. And therefore, it is named as scintillation counter. The photons are detected and amplified such that an electric pulse appears at the output. The pulse height is directly proportional to the energy of the radiation. The same thing you can see in this slide. So, what is a scintillation counter? In scintillation counter, the incident radiation is first absorbed in the phosphor material and the atom and molecules are excited. The excited atoms and molecules of the fluorescent material of phosphor emit optical photons. The photons are detected and amplified such that an electric pulse appears at the output. The pulse height is directly proportional to the energy of the radiation. So, in this you can find out the energy also. Depending upon the type of radiation, the phosphor material is selected. So, there are a number of phosphor materials which are available and which scintillate or which emit the light flashes. So, for example, for alpha particle, zinc sulfide crystal is used. For beta particle, anthracite or naphthalene is used. And for gamma particles, sodium iodide is used. Now, in the construction of this scintillation counter, we have the essential parts of the scintillation counter, which are mainly three essential parts. Among that, the first one is scintillator, or which is nothing but a phosphor material. So, what is this? It is a suitable scintillation material such as zinc sulfide, calcium tungstate, organic crystals, certain organic liquids and even plastics which scintillates, which means which emit light when exposed to radiation. So, any radiation, alpha, beta, gamma radiation. These are called by the common name phosphor. When an incident charged particle passes through the phosphor and stops in it completely, it gives its entire energy to excite the molecules of the phosphor. So, the radiation dissipates its full energy in the phosphor material. It loses, dissipates means it loses all its energy in the phosphor material, and that energy is utilized to excite the atoms and molecules of the phosphor material. And when they are excited, they emit the light. So, that is called as a scintillations. The excited molecules of phosphor produce a light flash. So, light flash is nothing but a scintillation in a very short interval of time. So, this interval of time is very, it is as good as it is instantly, emitting the light. The light interval, the interval of time is of the order of 10 raised to minus 7 or 2 10 raised to minus 9, depending upon the nature of the phosphor material. So, it is a fraction of a second, 10 raised to minus 7 to 10 raised to minus 9 seconds. Within this small time, the light flash is emitted. The stopping power of phosphor depends upon its size, density of the material, nuclear charge and also nature of the incident particle. So, how many light flashes are given out? It is depending upon what? It is depending upon the nature of radiation, the energy of the radiation, nuclear charge, then the phosphor, nature of the phosphor also, size, density, etc. Okay, so it is a function of both the incident particle specifications as well as the phosphor material specifications. So, this is the first part of it. In the second part, what we have is the photo multiplier tube. So from the name itself, you can see the photomultiplier tube. So whatever you have, the light flashes, they are multiplied in this. So photomultiplier tubes are special devices which pick up the light flash on their photocathodes from the phosphor and produce photoelectrons. Okay, this is a very famous phenomena that you have studied in your second year PUC, which is called as the photoelectric effect. Okay, and this photoelectric effect was first described and investigated by Albert Einstein, for which he has got a Nobel Prize in 1905. So he gave the explanation of photoelectric effect. So this photomultiplier tubes, they are acting, or their action is based on the photoelectric effect. So whatever the light flashes, they are produced by the phosphor material, they are caught by the photocathodes of the photomultiplier tube. When light is incident on the photocathode, they emit the photoelectron. So how do you explain the photoelectric effect? When light radiation of suitable frequency falls on a photocathode, it emits photoelectrons. So that is called as a photoelectric effect. So same thing is happening here. Photocathodes from the, light flash on their photocathodes from the phosphor and produce photoelectrons. There are several dianodes. So dianodes are nothing but basically they are electrodes, arranged in such a way that an alternating field is applied between various successive dianodes, as shown in figure 1. After this, I will be showing you the figure. The photoelectrons are multiplied 4 to 5 times when they are accelerated between the photocathode and the first dianode. Every successive dianode accelerates the secondary electrons further. The final pulse is delivered at the anode, where it is amplified, and after discrimination from the noise level pulses, it is given to the recording scalars and counters. Okay. Now, the third part of this is the electronic devices. Which are they? These include amplifier, basically, discriminator and counter. Okay, these are the very basic part of this. Okay, and how they vary, this counting thing, counters and scalars, how they vary, I will show you in the next diagram when we have the block diagram of the scintillation counter. An amplifier amplifies the pulses from the photomultiplier. The function of an amplifier is what? It amplifies the pulses from the photomultiplier. Discriminator is an electronic device for sorting out the required size of pulses from all those passed on by the amplifier. Hence, only those pulses above certain required pulse height will be counted. Counter is a device in which the count rate, that is the number of pulses per unit time, is recorded. In some counters, CRO is used as a electronic counting device. Okay, the same thing is shown in this diagram. So you can just see the diagram here. So in the diagram, the first diagram, figure 1, you have the diagram of this part is nothing but a scintillator, or which is a phosphor material. Okay, this part, it is a photomultiplier tube. Okay, and whatever you have, the photoelectrons from this photomultiplier tube, they are given to the anode and to the external circuit. Now, high energy radiation is falling or incident on the phosphor material. It dissipates its energy into the phosphor material and light flashes are emitted. You can see here, the light flashes are emitted. Okay, so the light flashes are emitted. Low energy photons are emitted. So these light flashes or these radiations, they are falling on the cathode. This is the cathode. Okay. So, this whole thing is called as a photomultiplier tube. This one. Okay. So, light flashes, they are falling on the photocathode and photoelectric effect takes place and you get the emission of the photoelectrons. You can see primary electrons are emitted. Okay. And there is a focusing electrode by which these primary electrons are focused on the first dianode. Okay, you can see this is D1, this is D2, this is D3, D4, D5, D6, D7, D8, D9, D10, D11 and D12. Okay. So these are all are the electrodes which are given the name as the dynode. Okay. And these are arranged at the successive high potentials. Okay. These together it is called as a photomultiplier tube. So this is the track of the primary electrons, and these primary electrons are falling on the first dynode, that is D1. Okay. Now these dynodes, they are specially coated by the material which emit the secondary electrons. So this dynode, it emits the secondary electrons. They are falling on the D2, the second dynode, which is at a higher potential. Okay. So this again focuses it to D3, then D4, then D5, like that you have the multiplication of photoelectrons take place. Now suppose if there are n number of dynodes, then this multiplication takes place n minus 1 number of times, and all the electrons, they are caught at the last dynode, which acts as the anode, and this anode supplies all the electrons to the external circuit. Okay, so that is the working of the phosphor as well as the photomultiplier tube. Okay, the same thing is shown in your second diagram. This is a block diagram in which what you have a detector. This detector is this whole part. Okay, so this detector, at the end of this detector, what you get? You get a photo, that is photoelectrons are emitted and they are caught by this anode. Then these pulses, whatever emitted, that is either a charge pulse or a voltage pulse is emitted, they are caught by amplified, then amplifier, it is again amplified, then discriminator, and then it is given to the scalar. And in the scalar, all the light pulses, all the current or voltage pulses, they are detected and counted. Okay. Or else what happened? This after amplification, they are fed to a oscilloscope, that is a cathode ray oscilloscope, CRO. All of you have seen that CRO. So either they are given like this to the scalar, or else they are fed to the oscilloscope, and wherein you can find out the pulse height, you can count the pulses, and you can find out what is the energy of the pulses also. Okay. And you can actually see the pulses on the screen of the oscilloscope. Or else they are fed to multi-channel analyzer, in which again you can analyze the pulses and you can find out the count rate as well as the energy of the pulses. Okay, so these are the different types of the, say, external circuit devices. And this is a high voltage, which is, I mean, given to the, this high voltage is given to the dynodes. Okay, the potential is supplied to the dynodes here, for the which will develop the accelerating potential for the multiplication and the acceleration of the photoelectrons. Okay, so that is the working of this. The same working we have just mentioned here. So in working, what you have, the incident radiation dissipates, the meaning of dissipation is loses its energy in phosphor, and optical photons are emitted. The number of photons obtained depends on photoelectric work function. Photons from the phosphor strike the photocathode, which causes the emission of photoelectrons. The number of electrons emitted at the photocathode are proportional to what? The number of photons incident on it. And number of photons in turn, they are proportional to what? The energy of the incident radiation. These photoelectrons are directed by suitably arranged electric field to an electrode called dynode, which is held positive with respect to the cathode. Then the dynode has a specially prepared surface which leads to secondary emission. The electrons at D1 are then directed to successive dynodes D2, D3, etc., which are at higher potentials. If there are n dynodes, then multiplication of electron takes place up to n minus 1 dynode. All the electrons are collected on the nth dynode. This gives an electric pulse, either a voltage or charge pulse of the order of MV. MV is millivolt. Okay, so 10 raised to minus 3 volt. Then this gives an electric pulse, either a voltage or charge pulse of the order of MV. This pulse is amplified such that output pulse will be of the order of 0 to 10 V. The pulse height is directly proportional to the energy of radiation. The output pulses are then analyzed and recorded in the scalars. Okay. So this is a major advantage. Since using the pulse height, you can determine the energy of the radiation. So this is an additional thing which we did not have this in GM counter. Okay. So we can have detection of the radiation, the counting rate we can find out, and we can also find out the energy of radiation, and hence the velocity also we can find out. So what are the advantages of scintillation counter over the GM counter? So in the advantages we have, the counting rate is very very high, of the order of 10 raised to 6 counts per second. Okay, which is, but in GM counter we have comparatively a low count rate. Okay. It is about 200 times more than in the GM counter. Its efficiency in counting gamma rays is much higher because the ionization produced by gamma rays in solid scintillate crystal is larger than that produced by gamma ray in gas molecules on GM counter. Okay. So, especially the efficiency of this counter is very high for the gamma radiation, which was not there in case of GM counter. Then it is used to measure the energy as well as the velocity of heavy charge particle. Okay. So these are the advantages of scintillation counter over the GM counter. The efficiency of the GM counter is better for alpha and beta particles, and the efficiency of the scintillation counter is better for the gamma radiation. So for the depending upon the type, we have to use proper counter for the counting purpose of the nuclear radiations. Okay, so that was all about the detectors. We have seen the GM counter and we have also seen the scintillation counter. And in accelerators, we have studied the linear accelerator and the cyclotron. Okay, so based on all the nuclear instruments, we are going to solve problems in our next lecture. Okay, so you have to come prepared for the next lecture, and with a pen and a paper you have to take down the problem and you are going to solve the problems in the classroom. Okay, so we'll stop here for today's lecture.